The great red spot of Jupiter is getting smaller and smaller. Once 3 times the Earth's diameter and size, or about 40,000 kilometers, the most famous feature of the giant of our solar system seems to be shrinking more and more, also changing its shape from elliptical to almost circular. The phenomenon has been going on for decades, but in recent years, it seems to have accelerated abruptly. When we think of Jupiter, the first thing that comes to mind is its gigantic dimensions. With a diameter of just under 143,000 kilometers, its mass is 2.5 times those of all the other planets in the solar system. So much so that it would take 11 planets like the Earth lined up to cover its diameter, and it would take 317 to equal its mass. However, the planet is not rocky as the Earth. It is a giant ball of gas formed mostly by hydrogen and helium. Its size suggests that it was the first planet to form in the solar system when it incorporated the leftovers of the gases that had formed the Sun. Jupiter also turns very fast on itself. A day there lasts only 10 hours, and this is the main cause of its extraordinary multicolored livery with parallel bands, the origin of which, however, is not completely clear. The simplest interpretation is that in the zones, the higher color bands, ascending motions take place, while in the belts, darker bands, descending motions take place. The clear confinement of the bands is controlled by very strong jet streams that blow in opposite directions. A secondary issue is that of the different coloring of the atmospheric structures. The only hypothesis that seems reasonable at the moment is that the different shades derive from substances present in traces, probably organic molecules and phosphorus compounds, which interact with light depending on the physical and chemical conditions of the environment. The determining parameters would be temperature and radiation of solar ultraviolet radiation. But surely the characteristic that most gives an idea of the size of the planet is the enormous and bubbling red hurricane that has been swirling in the atmosphere of the giant of the solar system for centuries, the Great Red Spot, the structure that has fascinated terrestrial astronomers for generations. The storm is located in the southern hemisphere of the planet, at a latitude of minus 20 degrees, and contained between two atmospheric bands, themselves bounded by jet streams pushing in opposite directions. The atmospheric circulation inside it is counterclockwise, which classifies the Great Vortex as an immense high-pressure system, the largest in the solar system, an anticyclone in which winds rotate at over 500 kilometers per hour, more than twice the speed of the strongest hurricanes on Earth, and which, according to recent observations by the Juno probe, towers 8 kilometers above the surrounding cloud layer and has roots that reach at least 350 kilometers deep. Despite many attempts to formulate a simple model of the Great Red Spot based on knowledge of vortex dynamics and turbulence, a fully satisfactory explanation of the mechanism capable of keeping an atmospheric structure of this size alive for so many years has not yet been obtained. Among the main hypotheses is the lack of friction with a solid surface underneath and the reduced loss of energy by the outer layers. On Earth, in fact, hurricanes gain strength on the ocean and begin to slow down and attenuate when they reach solid surfaces. But on Jupiter, with no coast to discharge onto, the storm could rage for an extremely long time. The losses induced by viscosity could then be compensated by cannibalism towards smaller vortexes. In fact, the Great Red Spot applies the laws of the strongest and incorporates without much complement the small anticyclones that are passing in its vicinity, and in doing so, it probably acquires their rotational energy. In short, the formation of vortices seemed to be inevitable in a rapidly rotating atmosphere, where the vortices themselves can combine over time to produce larger vortices. The Great Red Spot is an extreme example of this mechanism. It is nothing more than a giant vortex that has lasted for centuries. To this series of extraordinary characteristics, the spot has for some time now been adding that of a worrying mutation in shape and size. a story which, however, needs a summary of the history of the telescopic observations that have taken place over the last few centuries to be well understood. Several astronomy historians still attribute the discovery of the red spot to Robert Hooke, 1635-1703, while others claim that the one observed by the English scientist in May of 1664 was not the spot we know today, too far away towards the equator of Jupiter, and that the primogeniture is probably due to Giovanni Domenico Cassini, 1625-1712, who observed it repeatedly from central Italy during the summer of 1665. The Italian astronomer also calculated its longitude and the period of revolution, describing it as almost circular in shape and one-tenth the apparent diameter of Jupiter. In his reports, he speaks of an island, but without mentioning its color. The spot remains visible until 1674, when it disappears again. It reappears weak and poorly defined in 1677, and then disappears again and only becomes visible again in April of 1680. After the umpteenth disappearance, Cassini sees it again at the end of March 1685. Evidently, some other astronomer of the time noticed the prevalent reddish hue, and the news went around the cultural circles and reached the ears of the Roman painter Donato Credi, who at the beginning of the 18th century painted a series of paintings with astronomers with their instruments inserted in romantic landscapes. One of the paintings, preserved in the Vatican Museums, clearly represents Jupiter with its satellites and a reddish elliptical spot. For a long time, it was believed that all these observations referred to the Great Red Spot that we know today. However, this is a hypothesis that we cannot prove, since for a good part of the 18th century, there will be a decline in physical astronomy. The efforts of astronomers, in fact, are now directed towards position astronomy, and the large, uncomfortable telescopes with which the great discoveries about Jupiter and Saturn were made are soon put aside, and the study of planetary surfaces ceases almost entirely, a period almost a century long during which no one has any way of confirming the presence on the planet of a spot similar to that seen by Cassini. The stagnation in planetary research, produced also by the events linked to the French Revolution and the Napoleonic Wars, seems to have come to an end around 1830. The planets were once again observed, and on February 5, 1831, the German astronomer Samuel Heinrich Schwab, 1789-1875, the discoverer of the solar cycle, reported the appearance of a large loop in the southern temperate band, at the same latitude where astronomers used to see the spot decades earlier. This is not, as many sources erroneously report, direct observation of the spot, but only the outline, within which a uniform and faded elliptical region appear. Was it the genesis of a new spot, unrelated to the one first seen by Cassini in 1665, or simply the rebirth of that of the Italian astronomer? Between the autumn and winter of 1869-1870, the Englishman Joseph Gedhill, 1837-1906, saw the cavity clearly and with a markedly elliptical shape, yet still empty. But 2 years later, in 1872, he observed that something more substantial was beginning to emerge in the area, a very elongated spot that was easily followed even with small telescopes. In that year and the following year, Lord Rosse, 1800-1867, points out for the first time the red color of the structure in formation, perceived thanks to its gigantic reflector of 1.83 meters. In 1877, Henry C. Russell, 1836-1907, often observed it from Sydney and ironically called it the pink salmon, so much so that its shape appears elongated. Sightings are becoming more and more numerous, but also observers do not believe they are in the presence of a stable detail, let alone a re-edition of the Cassini spot. For each of them, the spot observed was one of the more or less passenger details of which the surface of the great planet is rich. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell. You will help us to make products of even higher quality. This is a story rather difficult to understand for those who, like us, live in an age where all scientific information is carefully archived. But the memory of the spot observed in Cassini's time had faded so much that the new formation was considered completely new, to the point that it became common opinion that the discovery of the Great Red Spot was credited to the American astronomer Carl Waller Pritchett, 1823 to 1910, who was among the first to publish articles on the subject. Paradoxically, denying or ignoring any affinity with the spot observed by Cassini, the scientific myth of the Great Red Spot, as it is known in our times, will be born in this very period. Only in 1899, with the article Early History of the Great Red Spot on Jupiter, the English astronomer William Frederick Denning re-established the historical truth, rehabilitating Cassini's observations and proposing a temporal continuity for all the subsequent reappearances of the spot. In our day, we are not certain that this is the truth, but what we can guarantee is that since the rigorous measurements of its size began, the red spot seems to have become smaller and smaller, changing also repeatedly of shape and color. Between 1878 and 1879, its length in longitude reaches as much as 43 degrees, which correspond to 50,000 kilometers, while in the period 1879 to 1882, it is already reduced to 34 degrees. At the beginning of the 20th century, the visibility of the spot diminished, and its color became an increasingly faded pink. In 1908, it is difficult to perceive, but in 1923, it becomes perfectly visible again. It is very elongated and occupies a quarter of the equatorial diameter of Jupiter. It appears vaguely hexagonal in shape and adheres, as in Cassini's time, to the southern temperate band. In 1928, the length is around 30 degrees, but in 1946, it is only 21 degrees, one of the minimum values ever recorded until then. In 1956, the spot is blood red, while in 1960, it appears dark orange. The following year, it is very dark, the darkest for a century. Its average length is 25 degrees, but in the 60s and 70s, it shrinks again, approaching 21 degrees. The color is bright red again in 1975, and in 1979, the Voyagers who fly over it estimated it to be 20 degrees long, equal to a linear dimension of 23,500 kilometers. Its color varies in the 80s from orange to very dark red, and in 1989 the dimensions do not differ from 20 degrees. Also in 1990-1991, the spot remained small and not very bright, and at the end of the decade in 1998 it reached a new negative record, even 16th equal to 19,000 kilometers. But that's not all. The descent continued even today, reaching an absolute minimum of 16,000 kilometers in 2017. From Voyager's measurements to today's, it's been about 40 years, and in this period, the diameter has fallen by 7,500 kilometers, almost 200 kilometers a year. At this rate, what we used to consider one of the most spectacular and enduring peculiarities of the solar system risks disappearing by 2100. In short, we have gone from assuming that the gigantic anticyclonic vortex that has been perpetuating itself for centuries on Jupiter could go through phases of instability, or even fear that the hurricane will be completely extinguished, like any other characteristic of the turbulent Jovian atmosphere. Obviously, ours is just a provocation, because in reality, we don't know if this trend will continue for a long time, or if it will even change its sign. But perhaps the understanding of the mechanism that originates and feeds this enormous vortex may come from witnessing its disappearance, and then its possible resurrection. Who knows? We will probably know something more about it within the next decade.